In the 43 years that I have been immersed in the politics of Washington, from one end of Pennsylvania Avenue to the other, I would say flatly that I have never seen it this dysfunctional. Now, Jim talked about the kind of political system that the framers created, which was not designed to be smooth and wonderful and easy to fit the stereotype of people sitting around a campfire holding hands and singing Kumbaya. It was designed to be contentious and difficult. If parties were not expected or mentioned in the Constitution, it was almost inevitable that they would develop to organize differences to be able to create an orderly process of turnover in government and of organizing our institutions. The laws and sausages not being made comment fits very well. So it never looks good, but this is worse. And we've been through plenty of difficult times over those 43 years and even longer. The level of polarization, partisan and ideological, that we have now is simply sharper than we have seen before. And it's of a very different character than what we had when I first came to Washington in 1969, where the divisions first were over the Vietnam War, but they didn't divide along party lines. Some of the strongest supporters, perhaps the most significant, of President Nixon's approach to Vietnam were from conservative Democrats, mostly from the South, and some of the strongest and most ardent and emotional opponents were moderate Republicans like Mark Hatfield and Jack Javits. Before that, we'd had, of course, the deep divisions over civil rights. And the fact is, for those who've read Robert Caro's masterful works on this subject, Lyndon Johnson was a great national hero, but it never could have happened without prominent Republicans like Everett Dirksen and Bill McCulloch of Ohio, who fought against the conventional wisdom in their own party to make those things happen. So these were not divided along party lines either, and of course the strongest opponents of moving forward on civil rights were those self-same Southern Democrats. But that was a different era, and the parties are different now. And frankly, they're more like parliamentary parties. They are much more unified. There is no longer a center that was a prominent and vibrant part of what we had during most of those early years. They are vehemently oppositional in nature. And that would work just fine if we had a parliamentary system or a parliamentary culture. But we have neither. In a parliamentary culture where a majority acts and the minority vehemently, vociferously opposes, everybody accepts the legitimacy of those actions. In our system, when a majority acts over the vehement, unified opposition of a minority, half the country sees those actions as illegitimate, and there are consistent moves to delegitimize them when they're taken. And we've seen a lot of that over the course of the first 2 years of the Obama administration. And then, of course, you can get to the nightmare that we've had the last 2 years, which is a system of divided government because of separation of powers with a minority party that votes in unison, which leads to the closest equivalent to gridlock. And that's no easy or good way to run a political system. Now, if that were the only set of problems, we might be able to simply weather them. But it's become quite clear that some of the polarization, and I would call it more than partisan or ideological, it's tribal in nature now. Because there are so many areas where you can imagine and where we can find common ground, and where we see those outside the system, including with things like the Simpson-Bowles Commission or the Rivlin-Domenici Commission, come together across ideology and party lines and find templates to work. But when you move it into a tribal atmosphere where it's not what the ideas are, but who's expressing them, if you're for them, we're against them, then you run into a larger problem. And it's become quite clear that that now has metastasized out to many states. It's begun to infect other institutions, one could argue, including the judiciary, and we'll certainly talk about that a little bit more. And it's begun to move to the general public as well. Now, if we add onto that another element of our culture, which is populism, which is built into the DNA of America, our framers looked at government and looked at the accumulation of power in institutions as something to view with a jaundiced eye. And Americans have grown up with that, and it's a strength of our system that we don't automatically convey enormous power to powerful individuals or groups, which can lead to tyranny. Populism emerges, though, in a full-blown way whenever there are economic difficulties, and it moves out to other institutions beyond the governing ones. And right now, I would argue that we have a crisis of confidence and legitimacy across almost all of our major institutions, partly that's been driven by scandals that have emerged, whether it's in areas like religion or education or sports. You end up with scandals that taint leaders, and we have no institutions other than the military, which has its own set of scandals that we may talk about a little bit, where leaders are viewed with a great deal of confidence by Americans. And that makes the difficulty of reaching consensus or decisions that have broad bipartisan support, something that I think the framers, never mind the bipartisan, broad leadership consensus that they saw as an element that we hope to bring about in our political system to deal with the problems, as I talked about yesterday, of an extended republic. If you have leaders from outside that can help to provide some glue that holds things together, that Americans trust, then you can overcome some of the difficulties that are natural or endemic in a political process. But without those leaders and without that kind of leadership, and that's part of the challenge in the civil society that we will talk about, it becomes even harder to act, because action means requiring people to accept the certainty of short-term pain of making policy decisions for the promise, often ephemeral, of a longer-term gain.